Oh, hallelujah. Oh, glory to God. Oh, my God, I keep crosshaking. My God, I keep crosshaking. Oh, Father, we thank you and we give you praise. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, glory to God. Thanks for thine is the kingdom. Thine is the power. Thine is the glory. Thine is the honor. Forever and ever. Amen. Give God a hand clap of praise.
Hallelujah. Amen. Glory be to God. Come on, shout unto God with the voice of triumph. Glory, glory, hallelujah. The Lord is in this place. The Lord is in this place. Come on, let's celebrate the King. Let's glorify the Lord. Hallelujah. He's worthy. He's worthy. Glory be to God. I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. Isn't he wonderful? Isn't he marvelous? Isn't he good? Hallelujah. Glory be to God. Thank you, Father. We praise you in this house. We're expecting great things, Father. And we thank you that tonight our expectation will not be cut off. Glory be to God. Now, if you're expecting something great, I need you to shout unto God. Put those hands together and praise him like you know it's already done. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Glory be to God. Thank you, Father. Come on, greet your neighbor, your brother, your sister. Tell them I'm excited about what God is doing in your life tonight. Oh, it's time to celebrate. Come on and shout.
In excitement, the galaxies are waiting for this unveiling. There is a yearning for God's Son to bring his glory.
Bring his glory.
In excitement, the galaxies are waiting for this unveiling. There is a yearning for God's sons to bring his glory.
Bring his glory.
We want to see his glory. Yeah. See what was dead come back to life. With his great miracles, we'll show this cloud of wisdom.
We want to see his glory rise, see what was dead come back to life. With his great miracles, we'll show this cloud of witnesses. Our God, make it loud, make it clear. God's alive, God is here. Out of the ashes rises a new song.
Holy, holy is the Lord.
Come on. Hey, hey, hey. hands up in the air, wave them around like we don't care. The devil ain't got nothing on me. We lift our hands up in the air, wave them around like we don't care.
Something good is happening in your life tonight. I said something good, something marvelous is happening. Come on, receive it by faith and praise God in advance. Come on, put a praise on it.
And our God is great and glorious. We put our trust in your name, Jesus. For you're able to save and deliver us. We put our hope in your name, Jesus. Blessings and honor.
Blessings and honor. Glory and power unto our God forever and ever. All of the honor, all of the praise. Yours, yours forever. Bye.
is great. Shout, shout, shout. Oh.
Step past the
thank you, Lord.
Thank you.
Glory be to God.
Glory be to
God.
Oh,
the devil is defeated.
Glory,
hallelujah. For I serve a name that's higher than any other name. I serve a name that's greater than any other name. I serve a name that defeated hell, death, and the grave. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He reigns. Yes, he reigns. Yes, he reigns. He reigns over sickness. He reigns over poverty. He reigns over defeat and depression. Hallelujah. We serve the resurrected Savior. Christ in you, the hope of glory. He is alive. He is alive. Oh, he is alive. Yes, he is alive. Ooh, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come on, I just want you to keep those hands lifted and thank God for that reality tonight. Christ in you, the hope of glory. Ain't nothing dead about your life. Ain't nothing dead in your body. Jesus Christ overcame. And tonight we're overcomers because he overcame. Ooh, glory be to God. Glory be to God. Hallelujah. Thank you for that reality tonight, Father. Thank you for that reality of victory tonight. It is ours. It belongs to us. Hallelujah. 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 Oh, thank you. Thank you. Thank you so very much. Thank you so very much. Thank you so very much. We're not without hope tonight. Thank you so very much. All glory and honor belongs to that name. Dominion and power, it belongs to that name. Oh, come on, bless him in this house. Come on and bless him in this place. Come on and bless him. Just work.
Come on and shout tonight. Come on and shout tonight. Come on and shout tonight. Come on and shout unto our Savior. Come on and shout unto our High Priest. Come on and shout unto our Lord, Advocate General, Jesus the Christ, who single-handedly defeated death, hell, and the grave, and God rose him on the third day. And guess what? Caused us to sit with him in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. He's seated in majesty, and guess what? You're seated in majesty with him. Reigning over all, the devil is under our feet. He's defeated. Not to be mentioned among the victorious. Hallelujah. 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 Death could not hold him down. Hallelujah. Father, we thank you tonight. Father, we thank you. Oh, Father, we thank you tonight. Father, we thank you that you rushed us with this salvation. And we thank you, Lord Jesus, that you were obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. Oh, we thank you, Lord Jesus. We thank you for your obedience. We thank you that you despised the shame and the joy that was set before you. You endured all the pain, all the embarrassment, all of the humiliation, and you did it for all of us tonight. And we thank you. Come on and thank him tonight. No, come on and thank him tonight. Come on and thank him tonight. Come on and thank him tonight. Hallelujah. Now at the same time, go on and rejoice that he did it for you. Hallelujah. 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 Amen. Welcome to World Overcomers Ministries. It's our faith night. Amen. Amen. How many love your church tonight? How many love your pastors? How many love your worship team? How many love your band? Now go on and love on your neighbor tonight. Hallelujah. Love on your neighbor tonight. Amen. Hallelujah. Yeah. He's won it all for us people. Amen. Well, you may be seated tonight. We ask that you point your attention to the overhead for our evening announcements.
See, this is what I'm finding out with some believers. We're focusing too much on the problem and not the promise. Mm. God already knows. He's there tomorrow. He's there. He's there right now. God is already on top of that situation for you.
Amen. Amen.
Hold on. God got you. Don't do nothing crazy. Be steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord. For as much as you know, your labor is not
hallelujah.
Vain in the Lord. None of these things move me. I believe.
so that you can overcome every challenge in life.
Yes. Guess what? That's our pastor. That's our pastor. Guess what? That's our pastor. That's our pastor. That's our pastor. Faith man. Nothing can stop him. Hallelujah. Woo. Man, that thing makes me excited. Amen. 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 Well, adhere to all the announcements. Listen up. Take advantage of everything that comes out of this ministry. We just got out of a powerful faith revival. There are CDs back there in the Bodybuilders bookstore. Make sure you get it. Make sure you turn into Embracing the Word. Make sure you tune into Word Talk. Get the word that comes out of, guess what? Your ministry. Your ministry. Amen. On Wednesdays, there's noonday prayer here. Come on out. Take advantage of every opportunity, guess what, that our pastors are providing this body and this region. Come on, give it up. Amen. Now listen up. This is very important. All the youth, ages 4 to 12, parents and grandparents, listen up. We are planning for youth camp this summer. And give it up. And we'd like for those interested to sign up your children. That's so important. Now, your situation may not have been mine. As long as I was up north on those army bases, I was fine. When we moved down south in the projects, I had no youth camp. And old boy used to get in trouble. And that may not be you. But to prevent that, how shall a young man cleanse his way? By taking heed to the word of God. Get the word in him. Get in this youth camp. And y'all know how this ministry teaches. Y'all know how this ministry teaches. Y'all know how this ministry teaches. Get in the youth camp. Sign up for the youth camp. And get the word of God. Guess what? And I guarantee you will not have no idle days. Like I did. But thank God I still ended up being saved. Amen. Amen. Well, guess what? It's time to honor the Lord in our tithes and our offering tonight. Why? Because he's a good God. And he's already set this thing up with us through seed time and harvest, giving and receiving. Now, we're taught here. We already know the tithe. Guess what? That's not even an issue. That belongs to the Lord. That's 10%. And guess what? It's an honor to honor God with our 10%. But let's look at the word of God tonight. It's tithe and it's offering. Let's look at St. Mark chapter 4 and verse 26. Of course, we're in a ministry that teaches faith. So everything we do by faith. And we have faith in God. Pastor Nett began to teach and showing the importance of the seed. And the word is the seed. And this is a law that God has set up for us. And it works. Let's look at chapter 4, Mark 4, 26. And he said, so is the kingdom of God. Or this is how the kingdom of God works. As if a man should cast seed in the ground. Notice he said, cast seed. That's action. Not whole seed, not half seed. But cast seed. Or plant seed in the ground. And after he does that, he basically said, you can go sleep and rise night and day. Why? Because in Genesis, when God called the dry land earth, he already made the earth function the way he wants it to function when you put a seed in it. Okay? To sleep and rise day and night, the seed should spring and grow up. Now, he the man knoweth not how. But the earth bringeth forth fruit of herself. First the blade, then the ear, after that the full corn of the ear. But when the fruit is brought forth, immediately he putteth in the sickle because the harvest is come. If you sow the seed will grow and harvest will come. Who set that up? God set that up. That doesn't change. When God said, let there be light, you don't see the sun going dark. It's still light. Whatever God said stands. Now let's look at something else. Let's go on over here in Proverbs. Let's look at Proverbs 11 and verse 24. Proverbs 11, 24. And keep in mind, we're having faith in God. Because we have faith in God, we have faith in what God has set up for us. Okay? There is that scattereth. Scattereth or soweth. And when you scatter, you're flinging out a lot. There is that scattereth and yet increases. You know, in the natural, it don't seem like that should happen. You know, when I do my lawn, when I'm doing my weed and feed, I got a big bag. But when I put it in my, I forgot what you call that thing, but whatever that thing, okay, and begin to go over my lawn, spreader, thank you. Somebody smart said spreader. Guess what? The bag goes down, and it looks like I lost because the bag's empty now. But guess what? When it rains and that rain hit that front yard and those weeds start to die and that grass starts to turn green and to grow, guess what? I increased. I lost nothing. So in the financial realm, it could seem like, man, I'm just coming to church. I'm just pulling out of my pocket. I'm just writing my checks. I'm just losing. I'm emptying. No, but you're not. You're not. Because who set it up? God. There is that scattereth and yet increases. And there, now here's the tricky part. There that it seems like if I withhold more is meat that I'll prosper. No, God said that lends to poverty because the seed does no good on the shelf. It's no good until we sow it. The liberal soul shall be made fat, and he that watereth shall be watered also himself. So what are we going to do tonight? We're going to sow. We're going to water and be watered. We're going to sow. So we're going to reap and we're going to receive tonight. Amen? So if you have your seed tonight, ushers, have you served the people? Amen. There you go, Mel. So get your seed and let's stand up. And let's sow in faith tonight. Let's sow in faith. Let's sow in faith knowing that our God is a God that is more than enough. Knowing that this is my local church. This is the vision that God set me in. And God set me here to be provision to this vision. And guess what? I'm going to rejoice in all I do tonight. Amen? We excited tonight? Where the world overcomers at tonight? Where the givers at? Yeah. Amen. Amen. All right, put that seed in your right hand. Said, Father, I thank you. My needs are met. I'm out of debt. All my bills are paid. I have plenty more to put in store. I live to give. As I sow, I reap. I thank you. This law works to my advantage. In Jesus' name, I'm expecting my harvest. Now come on this day up, pass those buckets, sow your seed, and say, I will see you soon. I will see you soon. I will see you soon. Amen. 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 Well, as you're standing on your feet tonight, let's receive our woman of God, Pastor Annette Riley. She ministers the word tonight. Amen.
Praise God. Now put your hands together tonight and give God a praise. Give him a worthy praise. Come on, how many of you glad you're saved tonight? How many of you glad Jesus went to the cross tonight and went in the grave and got up out of the grave for you? Hallelujah. Come on, y'all sound like y'all praising me, not God. Come on, give your Savior a praise tonight. Give him a hand clap tonight. Give him a shout. Hallelujah. Great are you, Lord. Great are you, Lord. Hallelujah. 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 Oh, keep praising God. Just keep on praising God for a moment. I think I need more in the house. Can I get a little bit more in the house? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Father, we bless you. We magnify you. We glorify you. We exalt you. Come on, you know, I just need a few people that came to praise your God tonight. That's better. That came to praise your God tonight. You know, not just to look at me, because I'm looking at him too. I'm looking to him too. I came to receive from him tonight. Hallelujah. 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 Great are you, Lord. Great are you, Lord. Great are you, Lord. Great are you, Lord. Greatly to be praised. You're greatly to be praised. You're greatly to be praised. Glory, hallelujah. From the rising of the sun to the going down of the same, we will bless the name of the Lord. For he is good, and his mercy endureth forever. There's nobody like our God. Come on, make your worship personal. Make your worship personal for a moment. Who is he to you tonight? What does he mean to you tonight? Hallelujah. He woke me up this morning, started me on my way. Oh, I bless you, Lord. I praise you, Lord. I magnify you. Nothing I desire like I desire your presence. Nothing I desire like I desire your anointing. There is nothing on earth, there is nothing in the earth that satisfies me more than your presence, Lord. Hallelujah. Come on, can anybody say that tonight? There is nothing in this earth that satisfies me more than your presence, Lord. Hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah to God. Hallelujah to God. Praise your name, Father. Oh, you know, all it takes is a little bit of worship, just a little bit of praise to get stirred up. Hallelujah. How many of you know God lives on the inside of you? You got to stir up the gift, stir up the presence of God. And it doesn't take much when we praise him with all of our heart, when we praise him with a pure and a sincere heart. Amen. Well, God is good tonight. Before you have your seat, let's put our hands together and thank God for the man of God, Pastor Riley. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You can have your seat in the presence of the Lord. I love the way the announcement video is made. So you got to see from God's perspective to make an announcement like that. You got to see through the eyes of God. Hallelujah. How many of you know nobody is giving attention to the devil? Can I get an amen on that? Praise God. We ignore him. And we focus on God. We focus on his word. And I want to encourage you from the word a little bit in that area, because you know, if the one thing the devil can get you to do is stop your confession, he has you. If he can get you to quit and throw in the towel, he has you. But how many of you know we're not going to quit? The word hasn't stopped. The word hasn't failed. So this is an opportunity, my God, for us to build our endurance. That's all tests and trials are about. That's all stretching you is about. Stretching is important, but it's for the purpose of building your spiritual man. The same way it works in the natural, it works for our good in the spirit. It don't feel good. It doesn't feel good to the flesh, but how many of you know just because it doesn't feel good, that doesn't mean it's not good for you? I'm going to say that again. Just because it doesn't feel good, just because it doesn't look good, that doesn't mean it's not good for you. Look at somebody and tell them stretching in the word is for your benefit. So tell somebody, so rejoice about it. Well, open your mouth and rejoice one time. Hallelujah. I want to start right there in the book of James, the first chapter. We're going to continue. We're talking about sowing the word, and we're going to do some more of that tonight. We know Luke 8 and 11 says the word is seed. So every time you come to the house of God, come with, you know, good ground. Say that tonight. Say, my heart is good ground and it's prepared to receive the word. So always come with a heart, good soil. You know, I love the way the scripture says, we may go there in a moment. The scripture that says, like newborn babes, one translation says, crave. Like sincere, you know, crave the word, you know, like newborn babes desire milk, crave this word. And when you get to the place that you desire the word, like you desire your necessary food, I'm telling you, your life, your worship, your reverence towards God is going to an extreme level. Let's look at stretching to endure. Let's look at stretching to, sometimes you got to stretch to endure hardness. Stretch to endure. Stretch to win this race. Come on, this one is going to put you in a new place. This one is going to put you on a brand new level. This one is going to bring you a new level of abundance. Everything that goes with God, but you got to stretch to endure. You got to stretch to go to a new place. One thing we have to understand as believers, sometimes things feels like it's a stretch in our life, but it's really just God developing our faith. Little do we realize it, but a lot of times we ride a long ways off the pastor's faith. And it comes a time in our life that we've got to start riding off of our own faith. The same word that he believes and the same word that we see God does miraculous things in his life and in the ministry, we got to start standing on that same word for ourselves. And I say this, look at your neighbor, tell your neighbor, you look good. Say, so good to see you. See, because pastor is resting for this little season, you're not supposed to back off from coming to church. Because the same faith in the word that says, forsake not the assembling of yourselves together, we do that when he's here and we do that when he's not. Why? Because we believe God. Amen? Amen. So it comes a time that God is going to require you to stretch to another level so that we can lean on him and lean on the word and trust his word for ourselves. Let's go to James, I said. We're going to go to the first chapter, and I'm going to read it out of the Amplified and maybe the New Living Translation. But starting at the second verse, it says, my brethren, count it all joy. Count it what?
Joy.
Count it what?
Joy.
No, some joy.
Joy.
Count it all joy. Count everything joy. See, either we believe the word or not. Either we believe what God is saying tonight or we don't believe it. The sooner we believe it, the quicker that word is going to have effect in your life. You know, I stopped debating with the word. I stopped arguing with the word. I just started receiving it. Because a lot of time we read it and it really isn't getting in our spirit. It's going to our common sense level. Count it all joy. That don't make sense. When I'm in temptation, when I'm in trial, count it all joy. That doesn't sound right. It doesn't sound right to the flesh, but I'm telling you, it's 100% right in the spirit man. And that's who God is talking to through his word. The word is spirit. It's incorruptible seed. So you got to let it go into your spirit where it belongs. And then it'll begin to take dominion over the flesh. And you're going to find, my God, that you will ride upon every wave, every storm. You'll be on top of it. But you got to start letting your spirit man take the lead. Because now if you send it to your senses, it doesn't make sense to the natural man. So we got to say amen by the spirit and not by the flesh. The Bible tells us in Romans the 8th chapter, the flesh is constantly warring against the spirit. The flesh don't agree with the word. You bring the flesh into subjection to the word by renewing your mind. So if God says count it all joy, guess what? I'm going to count it all joy. I said if God said to count it all joy, what are we supposed to do? Count it all joy. Now if you don't have joy, look at your neighbor, tell your neighbor that's your fault. Because God has already told us what to do. We've got to learn like newborn babes. We got to learn like children. Just do what God is instructing us to do. That's a part of walking with God. If we're going to walk with God and continue to do it our way, why say you trust him? We'll never see him if we continue to do it our way. But we got to look, oh, man, that's hard right there. That don't sound right. Well, keep meditating on it until it sounds right. Because when it get in the right place, it's going to sound right, and it's going to be right, and it's going to make you right. Amen? The word of God tells us in Matthew 6 and 33, seek first the kingdom of God and his ways of doing and being right. And then everything that we need, be it spiritual or natural, it'll be added unto you. You know, many of us, our lives would be on such a whole nother level. We would be doing so much more for God. You have so much confidence. You have so much bold. You would be unstoppable. Not saying that you are. But you would be on such another plane if we would simply hear the word and receive it in obedience. Just hear what God is saying and do it. Didn't Mary say that? In John, the second chapter, whatsoever he says, do it. So this is a word that you do, not a word that you just read. I said, this is a word that you do, not a word that you just read. And this is why we have to be stretched, because so many in the faith, or many that say that they're in the faith, is not in faith according to the word. Because how many of you know faith is obedience? Remember that definition? That's one of the definitions that we learn. Faith is obedience. Obedience to what? Obedience to God's word. If you can walk in obedience to this, how many of you know you can more easily walk in obedience to a rhema word? What's a rhema word? That's a word that God speaks into your spirit, but it lines up with this. The bottom line, but people many times can get off into crazy stuff because you haven't learned how to obey the written. If you haven't learned to obey the written, what makes you think you're going to obey something you think you heard from God? Or what makes you think it's going to be right and line up with God if you have problems obeying what you read that he has said? All right, I think we've heard that. He said, count it all joy. Somebody say, all joy. All joy. All right, when you fall into diverse temptations. What? So if we're going through anything at all, we should come to church and be rejoicing. Amen. You know, and I'll say this. What we know we are overcoming this trial and this attack on pastor's life and his health. And, you know, no, it has not been easy. I wouldn't tell somebody that it is, you know, that it has or that it is. But the thing about it, one thing I learned, you can't go into a ring to fight crying and whining. You can't be no baby and get in no ring and expect to win the fight. You got to make up your mind you're going to fight. Not whine, not cry. Something pastor always says, if I cry, I'm going to cry to God. Because when you cry to God, you get to his strength. When you cry to man, you get pity. I don't need pity. I don't need sympathy. I need strength. I need strength. So I know where to find, not saying that, you know, I don't receive those that are sensitive to the situation. I'm not saying that at all. But I'm saying a lot of times people might look and say, well, why is she this and why is she? Because I constantly go to him for his strength. I can't do it in my strength. I can't do this in my strength. But I know if we go... If we follow God, first of all, we're going to count it all joy. If I follow God, I'm going to count it all joy. Every temptation, every trial, he said, count it all joy. Well, I know I won't be taking no medicine for depression because he already told me what to do. I could be depressed, but I ain't because I count it all joy. I'm telling you, when you do what God says, you get his results. To the world, I should be on a lot of medication. I should be on a lot of stuff to go through what we have been through these past years. But I do what God said to do. God said, count it all joy. And that's what I'm going to do. Come on, give him a praise tonight. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I'm going to shout. I'm going to run. I'm going to confess the word. I'm going to say, God is able. Come on, somebody. You can sit up there if you want to with your mouth closed. You're going to stay defeated. You better do what God says to do. Or you're going to be the one that lose. And you don't have to lose. You have to do what he said if you want to win. When we fall into diverse temptation, knowing this, that the trying of your faith is working something for you when you follow his instructions. Let's look at it in the New Living Translation. James 1, verses 2 through 4 in the New Living Translation. Verse 2, it says, dear brothers and sisters, when trouble of any kind comes your way, not just financial troubles, not just troubles in your health, not just troubles in your family, not just troubles on your job. The scripture says any kind, any trouble. When trouble of any kind comes your way, consider it what? An opportunity for great joy. Can I hear you open your mouth? Can we give God a shout of great joy? Come on, a shout of great joy. Hallelujah. 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 Come on, that alone lets the devil know he's defeated. Because you're not supposed to be shouting. Hallelujah. Come on, who want to confuse the enemy tonight? Who want to help me confuse the enemy tonight? Come on and give God a shout. Hallelujah. 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 Come on, shout because the man of God is healed. Come on, shout because he is running up and down this pulpit, this platform. Shout. Hey, hallelujah. Glory be to God. Now, whatever you believe in God for right now, open your mouth and give God a great shout of joy. Hallelujah. 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 Give him a great shout of joy. A great shout of joy. Glory be to God. Glory be to God. All right, you can have your seat. Because I believe if only one person get a breakthrough tonight, I'll be satisfied. I said if only one person get a breakthrough. Because this word has got to land in the right place. You got to hear what God is saying to you tonight. And you'll get the breakthrough. He says, when trouble of any kind come your way, consider it an opportunity. See, this is how we fight. The weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but they confuse the enemy. Man, he said, cry, you know, roll over in your tears, just lay in your bed all day long. Are you crazy? The devil is sure enough crazy. You got to tell him that. I ain't doing that. I'm going to count it an opportunity. I'm going to count it an opportunity to show you what victory looks like in the life of a believer. Come on, how many believers we have tonight? Hear me tonight. When trouble of any kind comes your way, just get ridiculously hilarious. Y'all know how y'all can act sometime. You know how you act. Hold up just a second. Awesome. Hold up just a second. Now you know how you act when your favorite team score. You know how you act when your team's winning. Is that the Cowboys? That's how you act. And if he can act like that for the Cowboys, he sure enough better act like that for God. Hallelujah!
That's the revelation. That's the revelation. That's how you do it. That's how you do it. You got to see yourself as winning. Somebody shout, I win. Say, I win. Say, I already won. Give God a shout. Amen. You can have your seat. Glakatola moko shastaka. Mora basata. Hallelujah. Hey. Kekatola namana basaka. Come on, this battle is not yours. I said the battle is not yours. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Hold up. Look at somebody. Tell them this battle is not yours. It's the Lord's. So won't you let him have it? See, when you give it to the Lord, there ain't nothing but one thing left to do, and that's praise him. Praise him. Man, the army looked out there over in 2 Chronicles and said, what they doing? The devil said, what they doing? They got praise clothes on? Where's their armor? Come on, in the kingdom of God, praise is your armor. In the battle of the Lord, praise is your armor. Hallelujah. Have your seat in God's presence. Have your seat. I said, when trouble of any kind, comes your way. Oh, hallelujah. Tell the devil, thank you very much, because I'm about to give you the beat down. Tell him I'm about to give you the beat down. Hallelujah. You know, God didn't give you weapons that don't work. If it came from God, it works. Praise works. Praise works. It'll break every stronghold of worry, depression, defeat, anything that's on your life. Praise will steal the enemy. Hallelujah. So I'll say it one more time. Y'all ain't gonna let me get about one scripture tonight. Hallelujah. Because you know, sometimes this is what you need to do. You need to let the devil know that you're on the winning team. No doubt about it. I need you to know that I'm on the winning team. Now, it may not look like it to you, but it is not based on what it looks like. It's based on what God says it is. I don't know about you, but I'm not losing. I'm going to run for the medal. If I'm going to run, I'm going to run to win. If I'm going to live for God, if I'm going to call myself a believer, I'm going to do it according to the word. That's how you win. That's how you come in first place. The Bible says many run, but only one. I want to run for the award. Troubles of any kind come your way. Consider it an opportunity for great joy. Great joy. Listen, get that spirit of heaviness out your house. Get that spirit of heaviness off of you on your job. I don't care what you're going through. On your job, count it an opportunity for great joy. Some of us need to repent. Say, Lord, I'm sorry. Because there ain't no reason why I should be acting like this. You have blessed me. You have shown me your miraculous power so many times, over and over again. I said over and over again. God's been so good to you. How you gonna let this low situation get you down? How you gonna let this low situation bring you into captivity? Hallelujah. Look at somebody, tell them the devil is a liar. Say, I got great joy. And say this to him, say, and I got the victory.
You ain't got no victory until you get great joy. Hallelujah. It's God's formula. It's how God does what he does. It doesn't matter what it looks like. It's how God does what he does. He says, consider an opportunity for great joy. For you know that when your faith is tested, when your faith is tested, your endurance has a chance to grow. When your faith is under a test, your endurance has a chance to grow. Now, what does endurance mean to you? To me, it means, simply means this: I refuse to give up. I refuse to give up. That's what endurance means. That's some of the simplest forms of the definition. Just simply refuse to what? Give up. You know, a couple of things that Bishop Bailey said to us: go through and don't get stuck. You know, we make the statement from time to time. You call somebody and say, what's going on with you? Well, I'm going through. Well, then we should see you real soon. Because if you're going through, you're going to come out of that situation. But unfortunately, sometimes we go through and we get stuck. Why are you in church? Because you're going through? No. No. When you're going through, you keep going. Amen. So endurance to me means refusing to quit. You know, endurance means to outlast the enemy. And if we make a decision to do what God said to do, standing won't be as long as you think it will be. You better hear me tonight. I said, when we make a decision to do what God said to do, you won't be standing as long as it looks like it'll take. Why? Because once again, when your faith is tested, your endurance has a chance to grow. So the scripture says, so let it grow. Come on, stretch, endure, and let it grow. If your endurance, if your faith is going to grow, you got to hold on to your confession the same way at the end as you were at the beginning. Some of us might need to repent. Say, Lord, you know, I decree crop failure on some things I've been saying, because that ain't faith. You can't say stuff that's not in faith, not in line with the word, and expects the word results. Well, I don't know how I'm going to make it, but I know God is good. Well, if he good, you're supposed to know how you're going to make it. How God going to be good, but you don't know how you're going to make it? Oxymoron. Something's wrong with that. But when you get tired of the devil always coming against you with these cycles, the same thing, you should get tired of it. You got to get tired of it as a believer. And then you got to get in that fight for endurance. Yeah. When your faith is tested, your endurance has a chance to grow. Nobody likes to go through anything. The minute we get in the first little test, we want to murmur and complain, or we want everybody to know what we're going through. And sometimes people may know, because it may not be possible for them not to know. But it's how you approach that situation. And that's just an opportunity for your faith to grow. Now let's see what happens when your endurance has a chance to grow and you let it grow. What's going to happen at the end of it? For when your endurance is fully developed, that one got me on one foot. Y'all see that? My God. When your endurance is fully developed, you will be mature, perfect. You'll be complete, needing nothing. Now, a lot of times we may look at that from the natural perspective, but he's not just talking from the natural. The first thing we need is to be mature in our spirit man. When you can get in that place with God, there is no need that you have that won't be met. Because you learn that endurance, if I just stay steady, if I just keep my confession right, if I just keep praising God, if I just keep coming to church, say amen, somebody. Amen. If I just keep sowing, if I keep doing what the word says to do, how many of you know you're going to get the desired end? Because there's always a process to growth. That is so in the natural, so it is in the spiritual. There's a process to growth. You know, your spirit man is instantaneously born. When you're born again, your new birth is instantaneous. But there's a process to growing and maturing in the word. And that's why he left the word. So that we can know the way. So that we can follow his path. So that we can know what his will is. We don't have to figure nothing out because he's left the word. Now he said, put your faith to work in my word. So that's the part I want to get to. I want to get to that endurance so that I'm perfected and complete, needing nothing. Faith has to grow. And it grows, the scripture says, Romans 10 and 17, from hearing. Faith comes, faith grows by hearing, hearing by the word of God. In other words, if I'm in the midst of a situation, my endurance is going to grow based on how much word I hear, how much word I put in my spirit, how much word I speak out of my mouth versus a whole lot of negative stuff. You can be in a situation as long as you desire. Now, hear what I'm saying. The Bible says sometimes, you know, whether it's finance or healing, there may be a recovery period, but there comes a time when your spirit, when your faith connects with that word, that settles it. You know, sometimes pastor go through some days where he have some challenges, but every time he opened his mouth, he said, but I'm healed, though. But I'm healed, though. So it's something about when faith, when you have gotten a hold of faith, to a degree that it settles some things in you. And that's your responsibility to build your faith. The Bible says faith comes by hearing. Okay, I'm going to hear what God has to say, and I'm going to say what God said. The next day, I'm going to hear what God has to say, and I'm going to say what God says. Now, y'all know that's how faith works, because that's how it works when you go to the gym. Don't look at me with, like Pastor said, don't be looking at me with them eyes like that. You know how it works in the natural. What makes you think it works any different in the spiritual? The natural sometimes is a parallel for how things work in the spiritual. He has dealt to you faith, but you have to develop it. The same way you have to develop your muscles before you lift 200 or 300 pounds or whatever the case might be. But the word is right here to develop it for us. So you don't ever have to be in any situation that you don't grow from. Did y'all hear that? There's not one situation, there is not one temptation or any trouble of any kind that you are not supposed to grow from. Because when your faith is tested, your endurance has a chance to grow, so you have a chance to grow. Let's go to Hebrews, the 12th chapter and the first verse. The Amplified version, please. It says, therefore, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses who by faith have testified to the truth of God's absolute faithfulness. Ain't never on God. It's never on God. It's always on our willingness to do the word. Not hearers only, but doers of the word. Because God is faithful. Somebody lift your right hand and say, God is faithful.
God is faithful.
We serve a faithful God. God is faithful. We have a cloud of witnesses who by faith have testified to the truth of God's absolute faithfulness. He is absolutely faithful. Stripping off every unnecessary weight. Runners, when they run, they don't have a whole lot of weight on. Sometimes they wear very little clothes because clothes to them is weight. And if they have to strip all that off to run, how much more should we strip stuff off to run this race spiritually? You know, I can't help but going back to that scripture. There's five wise virgins and five foolish. The virgins is representative of the church. I'm sorry, but there's coming a time you ain't getting none of my oil. You got to get your own oil. There comes a time where the Bible says we bear one another. But there's going to come a time I got to put you down and you got to run too. You got to run this race too. Says we got this cloud of witnesses, right? Who's testifying of God's absolute faithfulness, stripping off every unnecessary weight and the sin. Anybody in sin tonight? You know, the Bible said just strip it off. You know, God will show us when we're doing things, if we ask him. He'll show us when we're doing things that's not pleasing him. You could be thinking wrong. How many of you know that's sin? Because the Bible says, let the words of my mouth, meditation of my heart, be acceptable in your sight. Joshua 1 and 8 says, this book of the law shall not depart from out of your mouth. So God has shown us how to please him. All you got to do is ask him, Father, what is a weight in my life? I promise you he will show you. What is a weight on in my life? It might be a who. But I know one thing. I know a scripture over there in the epistles that says, I'll let nothing separate me from the love of God. You can do all that stuff, but I ain't going to do it. I'll let nothing, no thing, or no one separate me from the love of God. You got to love God. You got to love God. You got to love him the same way he loved you. And when you love God, what his word says all of a sudden is not too much. We're not finding ways to get around. We are finding ways to please him more. Why? Because we love him. The Bible says that nothing, Paul said, I will let nothing separate me from the love of God. Nothing shall separate me. Nothing shall separate me. Now, if his love is that great for us, how much more should we not respond to that love? Because we always like to talk about how he loved us, but how about how you love him? Isn't this thing supposed to now be a response to that love? Shouldn't there be a response? The scripture tells us love is not just in words, but it's in your deeds. It's in your life. So you got to be willing in your own personal walk and relationship with God to strip off. Strip those things off that will hinder you. Unnecessary. Unnecessary. It comes a time in our life when we're at a certain place in this race and we're running for God, God will begin to show you that's a weight. That's holding you back. There are some places I'm taking you. There are some places in the spirit realm I want to take you, but I can't take you because that is holding you back. So you got to strip it off. Strip off whatever. I'm telling you, you'll be so glad. You'll be in a position to be more of a blessing when you strip off weights. You know, it's almost like a person, you jump in the water to save a drowning person. If they cling on to you the wrong way, how many of you know both of you gonna drown? Both of you gonna drown. So sometimes you gotta let some things go and draw it in with the, what you call those things?
Oh, y'all know. If you don't, then ask the Lord to show you. The little circle things you throw out there to save a B-O-U-Y, B-U-O-Y. Y'all know what I'm trying to say. Yeah, you gotta get in a position to help people sometimes. Not where they want you to be, but where God wants you to be. But do you love God enough to do that? Because until you do, things that you desire to do becomes an unnecessary weight. And if it gets in your way of pleasing God, it can even become a sin. The Bible says it easily and cleverly entangles us, so we got to lay it aside. It says, let us run with endurance and active persistence. In other words, persist on purpose. Like I said, it hasn't been easy, but I'm willing to give God the glory more for the grace that he has given us, the grace that he has placed upon our family to help pass. It's not easy, you know, and I wouldn't stand here and say it is. I wouldn't say it's easy on not one of our young adults. It's not easy on us because there's a lot that you have to do in helping in the recovery that pastor is experiencing. But I would rather, it amazes me more the grace that he places upon our lives to do what? Keep being persistent. Keep enduring. Keeping our confession right. Keeping our attitude right. I would rather give God the glory than to give you a sad story. I would rather give God the glory than to give you a sad story. Because I have a choice of doing either one. I can look at the situation as a sad story, or I can look at the situation and give God the glory. And you got to do the same thing. Because the devil, when he knows our faith is on trial, he'll try to make you quit. He'll try to make you throw in the towel. He'll try to make it look like it's not worth it. Oh, that's all the more. That's all the more I'm going to press. That's all the more I'm going to stretch. Why, Pastor Annette? Because I know there is something on the other side of my obedience. There is something on the other side of your obedience. And many people quit before they see the prize. Many times people quit before they win. Now let's see what the scripture goes on to say. It says, let us run with endurance and active persistence the race that is set before you. The race that is set before you. You can't run nobody else's race except the race that is set before you. You ain't going to the next level of race because you haven't won the one that's set right before you right now. You've got to pay attention to every word in the Bible. Yeah, Lord, if I was just here, I can't wait until I get here and I'm going to do this, this, that. But you ain't there. You got to run the race that's set before you And according to how you run this race that's right before you will determine if you ever get there, if it's God's will for you to be there. We're running a race, and we got to run it with endurance and with active. There's no such thing as passive persistence. Put your persistence in action. Make persistence somebody can see and know. And a lot of times when we feel like giving up, come on, that's the time you need to stretch. Because God really is trying to show you that there is more in you than you even realize. There is more in you than you even realize. And you haven't even scratched the surface of what he has placed in you, but you will never experience it if you're not willing for your faith to be stretched and for your faithfulness. Somebody say faithfulness. Faithfulness. It's one thing to have faith, but it's another thing to be faithful with your faith. Are we getting something tonight? Verse 2 says, looking away from all that will distract us, verse 2, and focusing our eyes on Jesus. Somebody say, I'm going to focus on Jesus. Don't focus on anything else but Jesus. I'm going to focus on Jesus. If anybody can turn my situation around, he can. He can do it. So why not focus on Jesus? The thing about God, sometimes we want him to just pour it all. We want the whole 100% of the answer right then and there. And he might say, right now, you don't need the full manifestation. Right now, all you need is peace in the midst of the storm. How about that? So when we focus on Jesus, he'll always give us what we need to make it through right now. He's already taken care of everything else, but he needs us to learn how to trust him. So he gives you just what you need for today. Today you need peace. Today you need to cast all your cares upon me. And all the time your endurance is growing. You don't even realize it. All the time he is stretching you. And you can't see the growth, but growth goes with stretching. Have you ever seen a baby stretch? You know, that little chin goes down and that whole body. Have y'all seen it in those little onesies? Don't they do so? And growth is taking place that we don't even see. How about when you just get up in the morning and you give a good yarn? Don't you just automatically stretch? Because stretching is so important as a part of our natural makeup. It does a lot for our bodies naturally. Stop your bones from locking up and your muscles from getting tight and all that type of stuff. Helps eliminate pain in different parts. Stretching is important to the natural body. So much so that God put a natural stretch in us. How much more do you not think that stretching you in the spirit is a necessity for your growth? It is a necessity. We thought COVID was enough. We were like, oh, thank you, Lord. We don't need to be stretched for another 100 years. Thank you. But he knows better. And every time he brings us to another level, he's preparing us for greater things. God wants to put you in a position to be a blessing, not just through your finances, but through your life. Our lives can demonstrate to people the goodness of God. Our lives can demonstrate to people the glory of God if we will allow him to do it through us. Are you hearing me tonight? Amen. So looking away, verse 2 once again, from all that will distract, focusing our eyes on Jesus, who is the author and perfecter of faith, the first incentive for our belief, and the one who brings our faith to maturity. Hallelujah for that. Who for the joy of accomplishing the goal set before him endured the cross. You got to get a joy about accomplishing. You got to get a joy about whatever your faith is hoping for. Faith is the substance of things hoped for, isn't it? It's the evidence of things not seen. You got to get a joy for that goal. Who for the joy that was set before him, now you can endure some things because your eyes are on the goal. Your eyes are on the goal. So joy is there. He saw what his life was going to represent for us. He saw what he was going to do if he could just get on that cross. He was going to take care of the sin problem. But he had to go through some things before he got there. What are you willing to go through with joy? Because that's the key. We don't go through with no joy. A lot of times we don't go through with no joy. We go through sometimes complaining. Let's just admit it and repent. But he went through with joy. Wonder if we can make that correction tonight and just begin to go through. Whatever you're going through, go through with joy. See, when you change your attitude, you change your atmosphere. The reason God said count it all joy is because he wants you to get in a certain atmosphere. When you can get in the right atmosphere, deliverance got to come. When you get in the right atmosphere, healing's got to come. We play worship round the clock in our house because atmosphere is important. It's very important. You'll only be the sum of the atmosphere you create. One great man of God said, everything around me affects my atmosphere. So something that doesn't bring, you know, the right effect, he said, I get it out my atmosphere. I can't have it around because it affects my atmosphere. And whatever's in your atmosphere is going to affect how you believe. All right. We're about done. I tell you, this word, this joy is up in the scripture tonight. We got to get joy in our attitude. That's the attitude God is looking for. That's the faith attitude that says, we know that you've already won the victory. So we're going to go ahead and rejoice. We're going to go ahead and laugh at the devil. We're going to go ahead and shout. See, your spirit always wants to do it. It's if we don't come in agreement with the word, whatever's in the flesh will always suppress what's in your spirit. There is not one believer who has been born again that you have a spirit of oppression. No, you got the same spirit that God has. So now we have to, through the word, learn how to give him the right way, to operate in us and through us the way the word says that he should, and the image, that image in which he have created us. Now the word will begin to renew our mind to the new man that God's created. We look in the mirror of the word and learn who we are and what we look like and what we should sound like. Amen. We learn it from God and the image of his word. So this joy that is, was set before him caused him to be able to endure. Say this tonight. Say, joy will cause me to endure. When you add that spirit of joy because of the goal, because of what Jesus has already done, you'll be able to endure whatever your cross might be, disregarding the shame. And he's sat down now at the right hand. He sat down at the right hand of the throne of God, now revealing his authority and the completion of his work. And he's given us the same power to do the same thing that he did. Let's look at 2 Timothy 2 and 2 through 3. And we'll close with this. 2 Timothy 2 and 2 through 3. It says, and the thing, I take it in the Amplified. The things, the doctrine, precepts, admonition, and the sum of my ministry, Timothy is saying, which you have heard me teach in the presence of many witnesses, and trust as a treasure to reliable and faithful men who will also be capable and qualified to teach others. Take your share of hardship. With any ministry, with any, the moment you became a born-again believer, Jesus said, if anyone will come after me, pick up your cross. But you know what? The cross that we are required to bear, the trying of our faith and these different things. Now, sickness ain't on cross. Poverty ain't on cross. He's already, so don't even put that in the picture because that ain't what we're saying. None of that. He promised you. But things that we have to deal with when our faith is being tested, that's what he is talking about. He says, listen, take your share of hardship. Take with me your share of hardship, passing through the difficulties which you are called to endure. There are some things that you're going to have to endure as a believer. But now you know how to go through it with joy. Count it as an opportunity to rejoice. See it as your team. I was watching a game with Joshua and Joseph, and man, that was a good game. Praise God. Those Gamecocks came back in that last quarter. There's nothing like a good game. But you got to see your situation the same way. Ain't nothing but a good game. Come on, your trial ain't nothing but a good game that you're going to win in the last quarter. Come on and give God some praise for that. Come on, somebody shout that said, my trial ain't nothing but a good game that I'm going to win in the last quarter. Hallelujah. I felt that for somebody. Stand up on your feet tonight. Let's give God some praise for his word. Hallelujah. Come on, open your mouth and just shout to God for a moment for his word. Oh, give him a better shout than that. Now, some of y'all are too young to be getting up so slow. Y'all too young. Glory to God. Open your mouth and shout one more time. Say this with me tonight. Say, when my faith is being tested, I will count it as an opportunity for great joy. Practice that. Watch what's going to happen. Watch what's going to happen to you. Practice that. And watch what's going to happen. In Jesus' name. I want you to have your seat. I want to give you an opportunity to sow into the word. Some of you. Well, all of you, really. Everybody needs to sow. And I want to say this. I really wanted to get to this scripture that is so powerful. Maybe I'll get to it Friday if I teach, if I'm scheduled to teach. But let me say this. You know what giving is about? It's about hearing from God. It's not a matter of one, two, or three, or four offerings. Ecclesiastes, and that was seven. God wants to give you an opportunity to hear from him to do something. Faith is obedience. I sat there when Brother James was receiving the offering, and I knew what I came. Can I tell you something? I don't ever give what I came to give, and I always purpose There are some things that you just know you need to do. Like, for example, if you got $500, you know you're going to give a $50 tithe. Well, you already know that. That's purpose in your heart. But then what is God saying? Because sometimes we got to do what, give God a moment, is what I'm saying, to speak to your heart. Because there's something he wants you to do for something he wants your faith to release in your life. And we got to learn, this is what giving in the kingdom is about. It's not just about raising an offering for the church. And really, if you don't want to sow another seed, then don't do it. Because this is not by pressure or compulsion. It's teaching you how to hear from God and opening up to put him first in any situation, especially in your finances. Because there ain't nothing you got or nobody else got that he can't get to you or replace. And we've got to learn how to have an active persistence. Don't back off of giving. Don't wait till Sunday or a conference to give a $500 offering, a $1,000 offering. Just obey God. Because there are doors that needs to open. And sometimes he'll speak to your spirit to use that as a point of faith. Release this and release your faith with it. And then leave the rest of that situation to me that you believe in God for. I sat over there and there was something else I was supposed to do with this money, but I know God told me to sow it, so I sowed it. And let me say another thing. This is not the time, and thank God you all are doing wonderful. I'm not saying this because this is the case, but I'm saying this to encourage you. Continue to be persistent in your attendance, and then continue to be bold in your giving. Because see, the devil is a liar if he thinks, after all how Pastor has taught us to give, that if he is not in this house, our offering's going to drop. How many of you know the devil is a liar? And thank God it hasn't. I would clap for that. I said, thank God it hasn't. So we know what to do. And we've got to learn how to continue, constantly hear from God. Because one thing you want to get, if you don't get nothing else, giving is never just one time. So if you heard from God for a second offering, and you prepare, you could stand to your feet. And you could bring it to the altar, as a matter of fact. And then hallelujah. Say this with me tonight. Say, I believe. I receive 100-fold. Say, I expect supernatural manifestation, supernatural answers, supernatural breakthrough as a result of obeying God. Releasing my seed. Now notice, don't just repeat something I said. You said you expect. Expectation, always make preparation. If you said you expect it. And watch it show up. Watch it show up. Mixing your faith. Seed time and harvest. Mixing your faith with your seed for the manifestation. Father, we just thank you tonight for your word. Thank you for giving. And thank you for kingdom living, because this is how we live. We speak over every seed that's sown, beginning with the word. We decree that it has been sown into good soil. Every believer in this house tonight will hear your word by the Spirit. And your word will produce growth in their lives supernaturally. Father, renew our minds and change our lives. You gave us the word so that we could do it and live by it. And as a result of doing your word, we expect the manifestations that are attached to your word. Now we speak over every tithe, every offering, every seed sown, every sacrificial seed. Father, you know the heart, and you know those whom you have spoken to, and if they have responded according to what you have spoken to them about giving, beckoned them to give. We decree and declare that even as that seed has been sown into this, the soil of this ground, it has already produced 100-fold, 1,000-fold, 1,000 times. And Father, we thank you for increase in the lives of your people in Jesus' name. Well, hug on your neighbor, love on somebody, and tell them God bless you, and we'll see you on Friday night. Remember, if you have children, stop by the table and sign up if you're interested in the summer camp. I believe there's also another activity sheet that you should be signing up on as well. God bless you. We'll see you on Friday.